हेलो, गुड इवनिंग फिजिक्स लवर्स. एज वी ऑल नो, वी आर प्लानिंग टू ऑर्गेनाइज सच वीकेंड सेशन ऑन फंडामेंटल फिजिक्स. एंड सो ऑन एवरी सैटरडे वी हैव सम फंडामेंटल सेशंस ऑफ 11, 12 अप टू बीएससी लेवल ऑफ फिजिक्स लाइक क्लासिकल मैकेनिक्स, ईएमटी एंड ऑल. दैट ऑल सेशंस आर होस्टेड बाय मिस्टर यश दाहिमा. And on every Sunday, we have expert talk on some research topic or on particular physics topic. So, for that, we have created one our group, virtual group, named Conceptual Physics. So, if you want to get daily updates from our group, so you can join our group. I will send the link in the chat box. You can please introduce our today's speaker.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Darshit. So it is my pleasure to introduce my teacher. She is my teacher from my BC. So her name is Dr. Ketki Patankar. She completed her MSc from Karnataka University, Dharwad, in 1993. And she completed her PG diploma in computer science from University of Hyderabad in 1997. Then she completed her PhD from Shivaji University in 2003. She was awarded DST ZRF and SRF during period of 1997 to 2003, and also awarded CSIR fellowship for her postdoctoral research from 2001 to 2003. She joined Rajaram College as MPSC recruited assistant professor in physics in year 2007. She has published 60 papers in peer-reviewed international journal of high impact. She has worked on many government bodies for assessment of college infrastructure and exam coordinator of various state-level entrance exams or tests like B.Ed, LLB, etc. She has published several science poems also. I remember her poem on light. So sometime I will request her to share that poem. She also published a book on magnetization of ferrites. She is now an editor of Elsevier recommended book on fundamental and industrial applications of nanoferrites, which will be coming soon in the market. She is also an invited course coordinator for Vidyamitra UGC MOOC for National Mission on Education for ICT-based teaching and learning. I am also working with her. So it is my privilege to work with her, and there are other people also. So instead of taking too much time on her introduction, I would like to invite her to talk, and we will enjoy her talk, I'm sure, about that. So over to you, ma'am.
Thanks, Yugen, for a nice introduction of mine. And at the very outset, I would like to thank this conceptual physics team for providing me an opportunity to share my views on quantum ideas. Whatever bit knowledge I have gained, I'm going to share with you. I don't know how many of you may feel it interesting, or some of you may even feel sleepy because it's like 9 p.m. about to go to bed time. But anyhow, I try to keep it more catchy, attractive, and try to make it more interesting, right? With all your motivation and all, because you have invited me. Thanks once again, and I'll share my screen and I'll present my this one discussions. So before I present my screen, I'm just going to tell you, because some fundamental ideas of quantum physics are required, though my topic is something like quantum physics, a boon for mankind. But then I just want to tell you that some fundamental ideas must be rightly perceived, so that then we can think about the, see, science before application, we should understand thoroughly the science behind it. So just let me go through some fundamental ideas of quantum physics. Many of you may be aware of all these quantum ideas, but still then I'm just going to, just to establish a link between science and application, then I'm just going to survey whatever we have learned it in undergraduate level, postgraduate level, and then go for some quantum ideas. And I'll end up my session with quantum biology, because some biological applications, see, everything related to human life in this corona pandemic and all, we are all worried about our this one life, okay, life related problems and all. So then leading a healthy life is also like a boon to the mankind also. Then so quantum ideas, quantum physics, how they help to lead a healthy life and all. So this is the way I'm going to end my session. So let me share the screen and I'll start my discussing whatever I have informations I have gathered from different books and all. So the title of my topic is Quantum Physics Boon to Mankind. I'm Dr. Ketki Patankar, Associate Professor in Physics, serving at Rajaram College, Kolhapur. So next, my outline of my talk is what is the difference between what is the difference between classical mechanics and quantum mechanics, correspondence principle, limitations of classical ideas, origin of quantum mechanics, wave particle duality, Heisenberg's uncertainty principles, postulates. I'm doubtful whether I'll be covering it or not, but it is included in my talk, so I just retained it. Next, we'll go for quantum biology, which is you people may be more interested in. So what is the difference between classical physics and quantum physics? See, we all know that the classical physics are classical mechanics is applied to macroscopic objects. Macro means bigger size objects and all. So applied, this quantum mechanics is mainly meant, or it is developed only because to apply it for the microscopic world. And in fact, in this era of miniaturization, when we are trying to make the objects very, very small, as small as possible, we are even devising machines at atomic level and all. So atomic level machines and all we are devising in the present era. So then quantum mechanics is very much necessary, or quantum ideas are very much necessary to understand the microscopic working of the microscopic objects. From good old times, we are all knowing that the particle and wave nature are independent of each other. In classical picture, we have retained this image, that is, particle is different and wave is different. But quantum mechanics, when we enter into the subatomic world, atomic world and all, so then what happens is they are dependent on each other and they do coexist. And now we have been accepting the idea that they do coexist. Okay, now next is in quantum classical mechanics, we measure the values. See, all measurable values or physical quantities are measured as a continuous range of values. But in quantum mechanics, we are measuring it as there is a discreteness. Because of this discreteness, there are dramatic changes, there is new functionalities in the material are popping up. That's why quantum mechanics is something which is, we can see that it is a very different subject, and it is leading to many, many more applications. Even atomic level machines are emerging out, new technologies emerging out. So this all we'll be covering in the applications, but this discreteness is also very much important. See, we are very much confident about the particle's position and at particular instant of time, where is the particle lying, right? And where it will move in next few seconds and all. We can trace the trajectories and all in classical mechanics. But in quantum mechanics, we just rely on probabilistic ideas. We just give a probability concept is always associated with the measured values. But even if there is a probabilistic ideas, the quantum ideas, we can't say that the quantum ideas are not unbelievable. There is what you can see. There is a lot of proof that yes, this is possible. Every new concept or new concept which is proposed in quantum physics is justified with an experimental verification. Even the wave particle dualities also can be it's also explained with the help of the some experiments. Okay, so though there is a probabilistic idea associated with the quantum idea, quantum physics or quantum concepts, but the thing is, it is in reality, there is a probability means there can be a maximum probability also. Let us not forget it. The phenomena is observer independent in case of this one. classical mechanics. But here, observer affects the experiment. You will come to know when I run a video on this. So how the observer is affecting the experiment. So this is the broad, what you can say, differences between classical ideas and quantum ideas. I just surveyed it for the people who are just beginners. There may be some students even in the audience, they should also know. Teachers may be well aware about this, but the thing is, the students, they should have a clear-cut difference between, idea about the clear-cut difference between the classical mechanics and quantum mechanics. Now, two main differences I have just separated out because with some intention I have separated it out. In everyday life, quantum effects can be safely ignored. See, the quantum effects are present even in the macroscopic objects, but the thing is the value of H, which is associated with the quantization principle, is very, very small so that we can't observe it in day-to-day life. This is because the Planck's constant is very, very small. And you all know it is of the order of 10 raised to minus 34 joules second. Quantum world is mainly, I told you, I'm repeatedly telling you, it is applied to atomic and subatomic scales, and quantum effects are dominant and must be considered. Okay. Now, suppose if I try to derive a law of nature without considering the quantum effects, without consideration of, then they don't work it for atomic level phenomena and all. So there's, the laws must be universal. That's why they should incorporate even the atomic level phenomena also. So it is better to study quantum mechanics and propose the laws if you people are going to become a scientist in future and all. So the basic laws or hypothesis what you are going to state in henceforth should incorporate even the atomic level phenomena or atomic physics also. So that's why the quantum mechanics, learning of quantum mechanics is equally important. I'm just giving an emphasis because quantum mechanics should not, you people should not be scared about a quantum mechanics or quantum physics. But in fact, you have to more focus on quantum ideas and quantum, because see the limit, if you just, if you make a transition from quantum to classical, the quantum is the extreme limit at one end and the classical is the extreme limit at the other end. So the thing is, there'll be a transition from quantum to classical when the things which are like Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, wave particle duality, they may vanish out for when you move from microscopic world to macroscopic world. But the thing is, at the bottom end, the quantum principles are underlying quantum mechanics, quantum principles cannot be ignored. That's why quantum mechanics is very much important. So I told you then when we move from quantum physics to macroscopic system, that is quantum world to my macroscopic system, it must reduce to classical physics. That is from atomic scale, that is of the order of 10 raised to minus 10 meter. When I move to greater than 0.01 meter, quantum ideas must be end up in classical ideas. So this was codified by Niels Bohr. And it is called as a correspondence principle. And this is what actually happens when theories are proposed, when principles are proposed, or when laws are proposed in quantum physics. What are the limitations of classical physics? Black body radiation could not be explained because it required quantization of energies. Photoelectric effect could not be explained with the help of classical physics because it required particle nature of light. Compton effect too cannot be explained with the help of classical physics because it required particle nature of light again. Tunneling mechanism, which you will come to know in quantum biology, even tunneling mechanism is also there. So that also required a wave nature of light, that is wave particle duality, nature of the object. It was required. Even light, and this is light and matter. Okay, you can see that matter and light, okay, any radiation it can be exist in both the forms. That is particle nature, it can exhibit particle nature also and wave nature also. Matter also can exhibit wave nature and particle nature also. Atomic spectras, you can see the discreteness in energy orbits and all, because a line spectra could be well accounted with the help of only discreteness in the energy orbit. All landmark discoveries in physics were made in the early 19th centuries. This revolutionized the perspectives of the physics and marked the beginning of modern physics. So quantum physics is known as modern physics. Now, what is this, how this quantum ideas originated? So our regular old Newtonian mechanics or Newtonian physics was applicable only for moderate speeds and even for macroscopic objects. But when things started moving faster, they were reaching the speed of light. So special theory of relativity came into existence. Then for small things and even faster things, quantum field theory came into existence. And when things were small, quantum ideas came into existence. We are going to concentrate only on this encircled or this part of the in today's talk, we are going to only think about this quantum physics. Now, origin of quantum mechanics, everybody knows that black body radiation spectrum could not be explained with the help of classical picture or classical model. So Max Planck was a physicist who came forward to explain the black body radiation. He could bag the Nobel Prize as early as in 1918. So you all know that when material is heated, it is getting its radiating heat and its color depends upon the temperature. Now suppose how the temperature, see, as you increase the temperature, the wavelength starts shifting towards the lower wavelength side. So emission spectrum also, you know that it depends upon the material. See the this which in which wavelength a particular atom is going to emit its own characteristic spectrum. The spectrum of as sodium atom is different from spectrum of hydrogen atom. So all these spectral lines are different. Why they are different? Because the spacing between the energy levels. Okay, that there is a discreteness in the energy levels. There is the energy spectrum of the the electrons are electrons are present in the atom, and they are definitely revolving around the nucleus. When they are revolving, they are having their own energy. Their energy is not continuous. It is not having a continuous distribution. It is having a discreteness, and the discreteness or the difference in the two energy levels is different for different atoms. Therefore, the emission spectrum depends on the material. So theoretical description, that is a simplification of a black body radiation spectrum, was required, and Max Planck came forward to explain these ideas, and that's why he could share the Nobel Prize for his quantum ideas. You all know what is a black body. So there is nothing that in practically you don't find a perfect black body, but you can consider it as an ideal black body for theoretical understanding of the black body radiation spectrum. So then whatever it is, see, the body which is absorbing all the radiations at lower temperature and emitting when it is heated to elevated temperature, it starts emitting all those absorbed radiations. So then now spectrum, what is black body radiation spectrum? This is exactly the black body radiation spectrum. That is, we are plotting the graph of light intensity versus wavelength, or the radiation intensity versus wavelength. Now, you can see in this spectrum that as the temperature goes on increasing, what happens to the wavelength? It starts shifting towards the characteristic peak also starts shifting towards the lower wavelength side. So why all this? And by this we get a maximum, a characteristic peak. At a particular temperature also we get a characteristic peak. How to account for this? The classical ideas could not explain this characteristic peak, and it the classical ideas fitted longer wavelength side. But what about the at the lower wavelength side, means higher frequency side? Why there is again a decrease in the intensity? This could not be explained. So the peak obtained, the characteristic peak obtained in the black body radiation spectrum could not be explained with the help of classical ideas. So then black body radiation required a new understanding. And this is what we can see as Wien's displacement law. And this is the relation for it. And in fact, it is given by this particular relation. And see, some formulas are developed empirically, means through experimental observations, they have been developed. Afterwards, they are justified by the theory also. A strong theory is justifying these experimental results. So let me skip this. Now, the very important thing is there is an ultraviolet catastrophe. Means at lower wavelength, the Rayleigh Jeans formula, which was developed on the classical ideas. So what it indicated as that when we move towards the lower wavelength side, the intensity of the emitted radiation by the black body should have increased infinitely. But the thing is, you see that it has been decreased from the graph. This is the experimental data, and this is the Rayleigh genes formula developed. Okay, you can see the dotted line that is based on this Rayleigh genes formula, which was developed with the classical ideas of classical picture using classical thermodynamics and electromagnetism theory. But then the thing is, why we obtained a peak? This was bothering the physicist during those times. So why we are obtaining this peak? This is understood only if you can consider that the black body is having a cavity where the atomic oscillators are emitting energy in the discrete way. If they are emitting the energy in the discrete way, means what? There is something quantum of energy associated with each atomic oscillator, which is present inside the walls of the black body cavity. So this helped, this itself turned the picture, because we could only this quantization principle could change the picture, and it could even account for this black body radiation spectrum. So exactly what Planck said is, the energy emitted or absorbed by black body is in discrete amounts. That what is that discreteness is, he proposed that, see, there is a packet of energy. When the energy is emitted or absorbed, it is in the form of packet of energy. So what is that packet of energy? That is called as quantum of energy. And that quantum energy is simply given by formula E is equal to h nu, where nu is the frequency of the emitted radiation or absorbed radiation, h is the Planck's constant. So even it was a very hard time for Planck to prove that h is tending towards zero. Right, but he could establish it with its mathematical, with sufficient mathematical justification that h is tending towards the zero, and his packet of energy is called as E is equal to h nu. So the quantization principle says that E, the energy is emitted or absorbed in the forms of packets of energy, that is the quantum of energy, and the quantum of energy is E is equal to h into nu. And the thing is, there is a discreteness, so I'm attaching the another integer, that is E is equal to N into H nu. So N stands for integers, it can't be fraction, N is equal to 1, 2, 3 and so on. So the energy is absorbed or emitted in the form of discreteness in the form of energy. So that is a packet of energy, that is E is equal to N into H nu, right? So with this, what happens is the longer wavelength side, now see here, and intensity definitely depends upon the energy radiated per unit cross-sectional area, per unit time, per unit volume, like, is that clear? So then what happens at the longer wavelength side, the energy, even you consider energy E is equal to N into H nu. So definitely when longer wavelength side means smaller nu, okay? Smaller nu means what? Smaller the energy, smaller the amount of energy radiated. Fine. Then what happens at the shorter wavelength side? Shorter wavelength sides, the atomic oscillators, what Planck had proposed. So then there are modes of oscillations. Like, but when see at smaller wavelength, definitely higher energy. So there are we expect the atomic oscillators to be high at in the excited states. But the thing is, The probability of occupancy in this higher energy states is very, very small. That's why the lower side of the lower wavelength side showed a decrease in intensity. That's why we get a characteristic peak. In this way, applying the quantum ideas, he could apply our quantum ideas and explain the black body radiation spectrum. And it's quite obvious when the temperature increases that there are more atomic levels, atomic oscillators start fluctuating more and more. They start oscillating rigorously. Therefore, what happens with increase in temperature, there is an increase in wave energy, and therefore the wavelength is shifted. Peak is shifted towards the lower wavelength side. In this way, all the empirical laws which were proposed by different principles, they could be explained only with the help of the quantization principle. Planck's quantum is too small for ordinary sized object, but large for atoms, etc. So this we can understand very easily if you consider an ordinary pendulum, that is a macroscopic object oscillating at frequency 1 hertz. 1 hertz means 1 second is the time period, because you know that reciprocal of the time period is nothing but frequency. So then what happens is this, if I just apply quantum effects to this one, you can see the value is H, okay, you know that energy is quantized and the quantum of energy according to Max Planck, what he proposed in his hypothesis is E is equal to H into F. So 6.6 into 10 raised to minus 3 joule seconds into 1 hertz gives me such a small quantization of the energy. But this type of energy effects or a small energy changes cannot be observed in the macroscopic world because you can't observe it itself. Okay, so they are ignored, fine. Now, you can just apply it for the atomic world. Now you can see an electron oscillating. You can consider a hydrogen atom, and electron is consisting of one proton and one electron. So around the nucleus, the electron is revolving around the nucleus in an orbit. Okay, even the orbits are quantized in atomic world. Okay, fine. Now the frequency with which this electron is revolving around the nucleus, let us suppose it is equal to 2 into 10 raised to 14 hertz. Now I start to apply, I'm going to apply this quantum ideas to this atomic world. Now here you can see 6. Again, E is equal to H into F. And the frequency at which the electron is revolving around the nucleus is 2 into 10 raised to 14 hertz. So what you get is 1.3 into 10 raised to minus 19 joules. For atomic world, we can't ignore this type of energy because you can see this is something about same as the electron's kinetic energy. You know now that when the electron is accelerated through a potential difference of 1 volt, this much is the, it is comparable with this kinetic energy with which the electron is accelerated through the potential difference of 1 volt. So this can't be ignored, or it can't be, this is quite appreciable in the atomic world. So that's why quantum ideas which are proposed are dominant in the atomic or subatomic world. Typical energies in ordinary life. You can see a typical energy of a tot, which is very nicely swinging on this one, on the swing. And E tot is equal to total energy of this one, E is equal to mgh maximum. We consider the potential energy also here. Now, suppose if I consider the mass of the teddy bear as 20 kg and it is it is 9. Acceleration due to gravity is 9.8. We can approximate it into 10 in 10 meters per second square. And suppose if they from the ground surface, the tot is tied in such a way that the swing is tied in such a way that the tot can swing at a height of 1 meter from the ground. So then what happens is we get the energy equal to 200 kg meters per second square. So it is 200 joules, which is much larger. Now, typical energy in an atom, that's why this effect is observable. Why? Because the energy must be large enough for people to sense the phenomenon. But then the atom, see, typical energy of the electron, kinetic energy in an atom, it is suppose 1 electron volt, energy gained by the electron crossing a 1 volt voltage difference. If you just observe it, if I'm applying a battery of, or if I'm creating an electric field by applying a potential difference of 1 volt, so then what happens is how much, by what energy this this charge of the electron is accelerated. The accelerating potential for this is 1 volt, so the energy gained by the electron, yeah, when it is accelerated from the negative plate, when it is pushed from the negative plate or repelled from the negative plate and is moving towards the positive plate. So the 1 electron volt is this much energy, okay? So this is appreciable when you're considering the atomic level phenomena. So to sum up, what I want to say is, though the energies are, the values which I'm quoting now, these are very much important in atomic world, but they may be less significant in the macroscopic world. But the thing is, quantum ideas are meant only to explain the atomic level phenomena, subatomic level phenomena. And when the technology is advancing so fast that we are reaching, atomic level machines and all. So we are inventing those type of machines. So when we are inventing this type of machines, definitely these numeric figures are very much important to us. Okay. Another thing which classical idea could not explain was photoelectric effect. This I require it in, because this has to be also thoroughly understood, because we are going to apply it in mobile sensors for our digital cameras, and all these all rely on photoelectric effect. So this application part also understand, to understand all this application part, people, at least you people, insist, or the would-be scientist must understand what is photoelectric effect. So when light is shown on the material, definitely the electrical charges are ejected out from this, electrons are ejected out from the plate or from the cathode, and they are collected at the anode. This is then, because of this, then if you connect an external circuit, then an electric current is established. So the question is, what were the classical expectations? Classical expectations may be wrong. In those times, they started explaining this on classical ideas, but this could not fit into the experimental results. So what were the classical expectations? That is the electric field. You see, the classical ideas is that when the light is in the is propagating in the form of waves, so the electric field is behaving like classical electromagnetic theory explains that light is electromagnetic radiation. Therefore, there is an electric field associated with the electromagnetic propagating electromagnetic radiation. So when this is made to shine on this metallic plate, what happens is the intensity of the light increases. Definitely, the force increases. Therefore, the kinetic energy ejected should also increase. But this is not so. So the classical ideas could not explain. You can see that the kinetic energy of the ejected electron, that is called as the photoelectron, does not at all depend upon the intensity. So this was contradictory to the classical explanation was contradictory to the observed experimental facts. Then another expectation of the classical physics was electrons should be emitted whatever may be the frequency. Okay, as long as E is sufficient, that is E here, bold E stands for electric field. The E is sufficiently strong, then the whatever may be the frequency, the electric electrons must be ejected out. But it is not so. There is something like a Wurf function associated with the metallic plate. Okay, so then depending only on the quantum ideas or the proposed Planck ideas of the that is quantization of energy, then Einstein developed an equation which could satisfactorily explain all the ideas which could not be accounted by the classical physics. For low intensity, they were expecting a time lag between the light exposure and but the electrons absorb enough energy to escape from the material. This was also proposed by the relying on the classical ideas, but this did not happen. So then who proposed it? Einstein came forward with a relation, that is you all know that photoelectric equation, a popular photoelectric equation. So E is equal to H nu. With this basic principle only, he developed that photoelectric equation. And the photoelectric equation is H nu is equal to H nu naught plus half mv square. Kinetic energy, half mv square stands for kinetic energy. So the maximum kinetic energy with which the electrons are emitted out is depends upon the Wurf function of the material. So taking all this into actual results, are the maximum kinetic energy is independent of the intensity, but depends upon the frequency. Mu less than, there is a cutoff frequency. There is no electrons emitted. There is no time lag also. The rate of ejection, the number of electrons which are the photoelectrons which are ejected out, depends only on the light intensity. With this, Einstein proposed this he said that light behaves like a particle. It is behaving like a packet of energy, and the packet of energy is again having the amount of energy is E is equal to H nu associated with it. So with this idea, then what happened is it started explaining this photoelectric effect, and the photoelectric effect was a very significant landmark discovery in the development of modern physics, for which again Einstein could bag a Nobel Prize for that. So all in the early beginning of the 19th century, all landmark discoveries which led to the development or progress of the modern physics, all the scientists in those periods, they could bag the Nobel Prize, because they were giving a new direction to the or new dimension to the study of conceptual understanding of the physics. So This all, I think, mathematical ideas, I'll just keep written it for 1 second so that you should all be aware about this. So what is the quantization of energy, then how it is related, how it appears in the different forms when you're applying it to a relativistic formula and all. So some physics students may be there. That's why I have just added this note. So this could be derived, because you can easily derive all these relations. Being a student of physics, you can easily derive it. So then, now we'll go for scattering of X-rays. You know that X-ray diffraction is a proof for understanding the microscopic structure of the material. Okay. So then there are two kinds of scattering, that is coherent scattering or classical scattering. It is also called as Thomson scattering, incoherent scattering or Compton scattering, we'll discuss it. But here, coherent X-rays are scattered by the material without change in wavelength. This obvious classical electromagnetic theory. So we call it as X-ray diffraction and all, right? Now, Compton, what is different? This different type of scattering could help Compton to bag a Nobel Prize. Why you'll understand it? It is there are two beams, okay, two wavelengths. When see what happens is, in coherent scattering there is no change in wavelength. In Compton scattering there is a change in wavelength. Original wavelength is of the incident beam is retained, but also there is a longer wavelength also comes along with in the scattered beam. There is a change in wavelength. One, the original wavelength is retained, and the other one is there is a beam with a longer wavelength or a shorter frequency. So this is what is called as Compton scattering. So we'll notice a change in wavelength. So what is Compton effect? A beam of monochromatic radiations, X-rays, gamma rays of high frequency, when they fall on low atomic substance like carbon, graphite, and the beam is splitted into two components. So the modified radiations is having lower frequency, as I told you, and or it is having a larger wavelength. Unmodified radiation is having the same frequency and wavelength. There is a change in the wavelength of the scattered X-rays is known as Compton shift, and this effect is called as Compton effect. So this person is Compton, and he could get his Nobel Prize for this new discovery, that is the Compton effect. So you can see the experimental arrangements, and from that, what you can say, the mysteries of the atomic world and all, or unresolved mysteries and all, could be resolved with this type of experiments on quantum effect. That's why he could get a Nobel Prize. See, the classical ideas said that, yes, this light wave, this is the incident wave. This is when it is incident on the oscillating electron, then there is a slight change in the position, and then the emitted wave also is having the same wavelength. But when Compton tried to explain this phenomena, actually the experiment resulted in slight change in wavelength. By that change in wavelength, he could say that even this radiation, X-ray radiation, is having a particle nature. It is just like experimenting with the billiard balls, and the collision between the two particles, that is the electron and even the incoming photon. So photon is considered as a particle here in the Compton effect, and when there is an interaction, there'll be a scattered photon and there'll be a scattered electron. Okay, so this scattered photon is having a different wavelength. Okay, different wavelength. That's why, and this Compton shift and all, this could be calculated theoretically also, and it was closely fitting with the theory. So what I want to say, this also could help us, this experiments could also help us in revealing many atomic structures and all. So these discoveries are landmark discoveries and very important discoveries, and they are like a corner milestones in the development of or progress of the modern physics. Now, as you know, that wave nature is required for understanding interference, diffraction, polarization also. And for understanding the particle nature, you require only so to explain the phenomena like photoelectric effect and the Compton effect, we have to consider the particle nature of the radiation. So again, electrons, you know that as usual, you know that from good old times, you are knowing that they are having a particle nature, but even the electrons can show a diffraction phenomenon. Means what? See, when when light radiation is having a particle nature and also a wave nature, radiations from classical ideas, they were radiated in the form of waves. and particles do not have wave nature according to classical ideas. But here what happens, you can see electrons being a particles, they can show, they can exhibit diffraction phenomena. And light, though in the form of waves, it can show which type of phenomena? Particle nature phenomena, which is very quite obvious from the photoelectric effect and the quantum effect. So this also, I'll share it later. Now, atomic level spectra, you all know this because Bohr's theory of hydrogen atom, again for Niels Bohr, was awarded Nobel Prize for this, for his contribution. He could explain, only with the quantization principle, he could explain the sharp line spectra of the excited atoms, okay? So this, I'll just rush through this, but this is why, because I'm showing it, because see the different colored spectrums, you might have seen the digital boards and all the different colored letters and all. This all has been originated from the quantum ideas. This is what I wanted to give an emphasis to the learners that, see, when we enjoy a very beautiful display boards with different colors and all, light boards and all. So then digital light boards and all, then this is all because of the quantum ideas which are hidden behind them. There are a lot of pains taken by these scientists of 19th century generation. That's why this type of what can say catchy, attractive, interesting phenomena or applications we can see, this today's generation can see. If we contribute, then next generation also can see such what can say interesting features or dramatic features. So this is the responsibility or onus lies on us also in contribution, right? So this is why I just thought of this one. Now, one important phenomena, uncertainty principle, is also required to be discussed. Why? Because this uncertainty principle also is applicable in biological phenomena. That's why I'm giving a little bit of emphasis on this quantum, this Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. What this principle states is that the position and momentum cannot be conjugate quantities. There may be energy time also. Such conjugate quantities cannot be measured simultaneously with high precision. There is some certain amount of, if you try to reduce the uncertainty in one of the measurable quantity, that there'll be a more uncertainty which is quite obvious in the other physical quantity. That is, there is some minimum product of uncertainty of these two measurements. So just this you can understand if I just see, this is the mathematical formulation, because we physicists are more acquainted to write mathematical formulas instead of writing the principles. And so the mathematical equation for this uncertainty principle is that some uncertainty in the measurement of the position and the product of uncertainty in the position in the measurement of the position and the uncertainty in the measurement of the momentum is always greater than equal to h upon or h cross by 2 or h upon 4 pi. So this uncertainty principle is very much important. Now it may seem very like something like very vague idea or something like it is not sound, it may not sound interesting. But when this is quite applied to some what can say applications or something when biological phenomena and all, you will enjoy learning what is an uncertainty principle. So let me little bit give an emphasis on this Heisenberg's uncertainty, little bit of Heisenberg's. This person's photo I'm just have included because a very important contribution he has made in this, and again he also could get a Nobel Prize for his work in nuclear physics and quantum theories. That's why I told you the physicists who were working in early 19th century, they have bagged Nobel Prizes because of their very important propositions, bold statements, hypotheses, right? And these were definitely formulated with the help of what you can say observed experimental phenomena or observed phenomena, which were very much intriguing or lying hidden in the atomic and subatomic world. Okay, see, this is the end picture of this Heisenberg, and as he has grown older, I've inserted his figure also, as his photo also. So he was a very talented, intelligent person. He had impressed his teachers also, and he was very ambitious, and he had shown his brilliance also during his schooling and even in the college level. He could always produce grades with straight A's, but except on the occasion of during his doctorate degree, the University of Munich gave him F in his experimental physics because he could not handle the laboratory experiment. He was very clumsily, he was handling. That's why handling of the experiment instruments was not proper by him. That's why he, this I'm mentioning, because here people who are good theoreticians may not be very good in handling the experiments. And those who are very good in as an experimentalist may not be good as theoreticians. But the thing is, wherever you are, wherever you can fit, you can give your best in that area. This is the, this was the point to be mooted here. That's why I just inserted this slide. One cannot measure the property of a particle. Why this uncertainty has been introduced in the measurements? Because we can't measure any property of the material without interacting it in some way. This itself has led to the uncertainty principle. Okay. Because here, if I just explain it with the help of this one. Now, suppose if I just want to observe an electron. Suppose if I just want to observe an electron. See, when we can see an object, only when you incident light on that object and that is reflected back to your eye, then only you can see that object. Can you in a dark room see an object? No, you can't see an object. So suppose if you just want to see an electron or something like our atomic level arrangement with the help of atomic force microscopy and all. So then, see here, something has to interact with the object, then only what happens, you can see those objects, okay? Now suppose if I make light incident on the electron, and suppose I'm going to observe the electron, look at this picture, then what happens is when the light photon is there, it is also having a particle nature. One particle, one ball, when if I just get it incident, if I make it incident on the another ball, what happens, there will be a head-on collision with the balls. Same way happens in the, when I make a light incident, what happens? The electrons get shifted up, okay? So when the electron gets shifted up, then what happens? There'll be an uncertainty in the measuring, in the measurement of its position, right? So how can you overcome this? The, you don't want the electron to get shifted, because then there'll be a high degree of, inaccuracy in measurement of the position. So what you want to do is, if you want to measure the position very accurately, use so that it should not move more away from its initial position. So use light of short wavelengths. When you are using light of short wavelengths, you know de Broglie's relation, lambda is equal to h upon p. When I use small lambda, then what happens? P becomes large. Then what happens when p becomes large? Momentum is of the incident photon is increased. When the momentum of the incident photon is increased, definitely what happens, it gives a big kick. So then what should I do? If I use light of small wavelength, momentum will increase. If I use light of longer wavelength, position will change. So in this way, there will be an uncertainty increase because of the interacting system. When you are going to measure something, you will have to interact with the system. When the interaction itself is resulting in the uncertainty. And this uncertainty, see here, using short wavelength, what is the fundamental trade-off? When using a short wavelength, you can accurately measure the position but not momentum. But when you use light of longer wavelength, you can measure momentum accurately but not position. So the product, there will be an uncertainty in momentum and there will be uncertainty in position. And there'll be a minimum amount of uncertainty, which is inevitable or unavoidable. Okay, these are some calculations. I'll just tell someone. Okay, postulates, I told you I won't discuss. Now we'll go straight away to the application parts, because this sounds more interesting and people are more interested how this quantum physics is applied in everyday life. Your morning starts with 2 pieces of bread toast, I think so, as a breakfast. And with a cup of tea, definitely when you think about the toaster and all, its working depends upon the quantum physics itself. Why? Because there are thermal radiations and all, they are quantized, which makes your bread brown and all. So the thing is, the working principle of the toaster itself is the pop-up toaster shown in this photograph. It depends upon the quantum principles or quantum ideas. Okay. Now, I told you that's the atomic level spectrum, which was explained with the Bohr's theory of hydrogen atom and all. So then all this light which is emitted in different colors and all, fluorescent light and all, this all works on the quantization principle only, or quantum mechanical principles only. That's why this fluorescent lights are characteristic lights are emitted by different atoms, that is hydrogen atom, mercury source, deuterium source, nitrogen source, oxygen, when the gases are excited. So therefore, what happens is the energy is emitted. Now, even your computers and mobile phones and all, they are used digital technologies. Their working principles are relying on quantum ideas. We have not yet reached quantum computers, but digital cameras fitted on the computer and mobile phone consist of CCD sensors, which uses photoelectric effect. Batteries on your in your smartphone are getting better by using electrochemistry. Electrochemistry is a part of physical chemistry. Again, it relies on quantum ideas. In future, we are going to with the advent of the technology, if we are moving from we are going to move for more advanced technology, quantum computers will come up, and you will start storing data in qubits. And quantum sensors will be very much helpful for precise navigation, and secure communications will be done with high security using quantum keys. So this is how the future of the computers and mobile phones will be there. So you will come with, you'll be storing when, the data in qubits and all. So this is the simple basics. Science is a driving force of the technology. Without science, technology cannot exist. Definitely, technology reaches common man's house. But again, to refine science, research is required. So my appeal to the students, participants here is try to think about the scientific problems, come out with your own problem and concentrate with the existing science. Think about what is to be revealed, what is to be explored, what is yet to be understood from this existing science, and try to concentrate on it and come out with new creative ideas, right? And definitely your science may be applied in future technology, and then you and that will reach common man's house. This is how is research is benefiting ordinary man. Okay, it is reaching ordinary man's door, right? Now, you all know that laser is a boon to the mankind. Now the laser technologies, they are called, their people are adopting the laser technologies. So many surgeries are done with the help of lasers. They are called as bloodless surgeries. See, the very idea about laser is definitely depends upon this quantum principles or quantum ideas. You know that is laser is light amplification due to stimulated emission of radiation. Okay, what happens is this all laser surgery is again, see the underlying principle of all these lasers, laser light and all is was only possible because of what quantum physics. We have to thank quantum physics because of this modern technologies are useful and beneficial. They are less painful, and that's why the recovery time is good. Healing of the wounds is also good. So if for diabetics, diabetic people, this laser has been is just like a boon to the to these people. Why? Because the detached retina, right? Or there is the toned retina and all can be repaired, and the patient will be discharged from the, after the surgery on the same day itself. So this has definitely proved a mankind, boon to the mankind. Even kidney stones and all, very painful kidney stones and all, they are crushed with the help of the laser light and all. So the advent of laser itself has proved a boon to the medical sciences and all. Therefore, this again definitely is evolved through the quantum ideas. Now, the microscopy, high resolution microscopy, surface electron microscope, tunneling electron microscope. I told you that electron is also that electron diffraction experiment. These instruments were devised only on the very, very thought or very principle, that very idea that electron also exhibits wave nature. So therefore, these microscopes were developed, scanning electron microscopes and tunneling electron microscope. So very, very high resolution images, right, which could not be resolved with the help of the optical microscopes or ordinary microscopes. It could be seen very clearly with the biological specimens, especially biological specimens could be seen very clearly with the help of high resolution microscope. And this is only possible because of the quantum mechanical ideas. How many of you switch on your GPS, global position systems and all when you want to find the route and all, right? So then the thing is, all these work on the atomic clocks. And again, the atomic clocks means quantum physics. So we have to again thank quantum physics or the people, scientists who have contributed to this quantum world, okay, or helped in evolving this quantum ideas. That's why this technology was possible. Next, MRI, reversal of electron spins in hydrogen nuclei. That's what I told you. This MRI is again a boon to the mankind. The per patient with serious illness, that imaging is required sometimes to understand what is the problem in the human body. So the MRI nowadays, doctors suggest many times if they can't diagnose the ailment, they suggest that MRI is required and all, especially for understanding the problems or tumors and all which are lying in the body and all. Right, there may be some disorder in the body, tumors are there, and even I have experienced it, even I have just seen, but I was very less aware that how I was not at all worried that time, and I was worried about my ailment and not about the physics when I was scanned through this MRI, when I went through this process. But the thing is, it has proved about mankind to the boon to the mankind, that's why. And the working principle again depends upon the quantum physics, and so this application could be possible. Quantum biology, very interesting, and you'll come to know how Heisenberg's uncertainty principle is applicable and tunneling. Only two applications I'm going to discuss here right now. It is a newly emerging branch in quantum mechanics principle, in which quantum mechanics principles are helpful for understanding the biological matter. Are we living things? The question is, are we living things? Quantum mechanical? Let us understand this. Just see here. Quantum mechanical phenomenon occurs in biological systems too. Is it not? Does it sound interesting? Very interesting it is. When a particle does not have enough energy to pass a barrier, right? Then what we do is, it is only because of the wave nature of the particle, we can consider there is a probability of the particle tunneling, and then you can find the particle on the other side, which is otherwise classically forbidden. Okay, so then what I want to say is, see, this is simply a rough picture to understand that if you apply classical, this person cannot pass the barrier, and therefore he has to lie down on this side. If he's trying to push this barrier, he'll have a head fall here, and he'll fall down. But when you apply quantum physics, there is a possibility that the person can pass through this zone, and he is, just to give an analogy, I just showed this. But the thing is, the otherwise forbidden region, there is a hope that the particle may tunnel and it may cross through. But when there is a 100% guarantee that this phenomenon occurs, that there is a particle tunneling, and it is occurring on this one. That's why the tunnel diodes were invented. Fine, the particle is coming on the other side of the otherwise classically forbidden region. Then how it occurs in biological system? Just here, you know that a neuron impulse, electrical impulses are carried forward through the neurons. Messages to the brains are given only with the help of, suppose if you sense something hot object, and so definitely you are in a fraction of seconds, your brain will receive the message that the object is very hot. So how this is? Because the electrical impulses are carried from through the neurons and they reach the brain. Okay, the messaging is taking place in the form of electrical impulses. Now, when this the messages has to be carried forward from one neuron to another another neuron, but there is something which is there is a gap between two neurons. Okay, so when the messages is getting transmitted from one neuron to another neuron, there is called as synaptic. The biological term is synaptic cleft is there between the two neurons. Still, then the electrical impulses in a fraction of seconds they reach the your brain. So it means what? The impulses are carried forward. How they are carried forward? Because of the tunneling mechanism. So just see here, quantum tunneling is also taking place. That's why the electron impulses in the form of electrons are transferred through this cleft, which is classically forbidden. But and in a fraction of seconds, they reach your brain, and that's why quantum tunneling is possible for transferring the messages or transmitting the messages from one neuron to another neuron. Now, you all know that cell membrane is made up of lipids and proteins. Okay. Now, just see, understand the difficulty first, and then you will come to know how the cell membrane works and how it relies on the quantum mechanical ideas. It is a double-layered, two-dimensional membrane of lipid molecule. What is the cell membrane? Let me define first. It is a double-layered, two-dimensional membrane of lipid molecules packed by, I have a lot of discomfort towards biology, but when I found that quantum ideas also can explain biological phenomena, then I started developing an attachment towards or liking towards the biology. Okay. Otherwise, initially I had a very difficult discomfort towards learning biology. Just see how it helps quantum ideas. So it is a double-layered, two-dimensional membrane of lipid molecules packed by protein filaments. Protein molecules act as active gates for ion exchange across the membrane. Just try to understand this biological process. Now, classical cell membrane theory. If I just apply classical ideas to the cell membrane theory. See, first of all, for exchange of ions, sodium ion across an ionic channel is vital to cell survival. So the cell membrane should exchange the sodium ions for its survival. However, a very intense electrical field, 10 raised to 7 volt per meter, can you understand how high this electric field prevents the ion exchange? Try to understand. Exchange of ions, I'll read once again. Exchange of ions such as sodium ion across an ionic channel. This I told you that protein molecules are beneficial in they are acting as a bridge for the exchange of ions from the cell to the surrounding parts of the body. Okay, and the sodium ion exchange is very much needed for its survival. Okay, cell survival. So then, why this is prevented? If you just consider the classical ideas, that a very high intense electric field prevents this ion exchange. In addition, the ion on one side of the membrane are bound to the proteins. Okay, the ions on the one side of the membrane is inside the cell, they are bound to the proteins and trapped there. The barrier is completely impenetrable in classical terms. The barrier is completely impenetrable in classical terms. But still, then ion exchange is taking place because our cells are in our human body are surviving. So how this is possible? Only the answer lies in quantum mechanical approach, that is applying the quantum mechanical principles. See, the transfer of the ions takes place in a fraction of second, very small fraction of seconds, that is 5 into 10 raised to minus less than what you can say picoseconds, 5 into 10 raised to minus 14 seconds. So when this is very, very small, this becomes there will be more uncertainty or more fluctuations in this. Try to understand. This is very, very small. This is very, very small. So there will be more fluctuations in this. When this is, there will be more fluctuations in this, then the energy can surpasses, means it can overperform the electric field energy, or it can improve its performance and it can ignore this electric field energy, and therefore this ion exchange is possible. See, very small, this amount leads to small, large fluctuations in this change in energy. So that time what happens, this energy variation can surpass electron electric field energy, which was therefore it was very, very high, that is 10 raised to 7. So this variations can surpass this, you can overcome this variations, and therefore the ion exchange becomes quantum mechanically possible. So even in biological phenomena, these things are possible. Only two standard examples I have taken. There is a lot of quantum biology which is evolving, and it will again, evolve still further. And there will be a lot of progress and contributions from the scientists, biologists in this phenomena. So nowadays research is of multidisciplinary research. Physicists, biologists should work together and evolve with and concentrate on a new thought and all, and try to apply physical principles in biological phenomena, biological phenomena or biological specimens, and prove with this remark I'll end up my today's talk. Thank you. I'm grateful to you all for a very patient hearing, and if there are any doubts or questions, I'll definitely try to, I would like to answer them.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for nice presentation. So, as our participants are physics lover as well as they are physics enthusiastic, they are physics curious. So, they have some questions in their mind. I will be narrating some questions from the chat, and the people who have not written the question on the chat, they will be given opportunity to ask the question by raising a hand. So, I'm reading a question from the chat.
Can I stop sharing my screen?
Yes, you can. The first question from the chat is, can we say that when Planck constant is equal to zero, we are jumping into the classical domain?
No, it is. There is a limit. No, I told you it is approaching zero. It is not equal to zero. Even that fraction 10 raised to minus 34 is sizable in the atomic world.
What is special behind taking Planck's constant in Heisenberg uncertainty principle? That means in that formula, why only Planck constant appears and why nothing else?
The Planck's, okay, the very idea or the very, I think we started with the Planck's constant itself. Well, when we are describing the quantum of energy, right? We said that the energy is quantized, okay? In the we just multiplied this factor, that is the scaling factor was h cross or h, you can say, right? E is equal to h nu, fine? So when the very proposition of the quantum theory or very the foundation stone or the very energy measurement started with the inclusion of H, then how can it be avoided? This is my perspective. Huh? I may not be 100% true, or you can even say this question, we can still think about, or we can leave it to the group also for having a, what can say, brainstorming discussions on this. But the thing is, I think the minimum limit also should end up with H cross only. This is what I try to justify from my side.
The next question is, in stimulated emission, when the energy is given to the particle in the excited state, then why it gets back to the down state? Whereas we learn in BSc that if energy is provided, then atom is excited, but in stimulated emission, it happens the opposite. So why does it happen?
Okay. See here, we are, okay, the atom, initially there is, the atom is excited, okay? In the excited state, we are providing an energy, you are providing a photon, which is having that much of energy, fine? So that will push up that excited atom to come down. Definitely, see, there is a lifetime for the energy level also. So they can't rest very for a long period in that energy level. Definitely, spontaneously, they have to come back to its ground state. Every energy level is having its own lifetime. The atom in that excited state cannot rest for a long period in that excited state. Is that clear? So that's why they have to come down. That time you are applying, you are compelling it to come down with the help of Langer photon. So that's why there is a light amplification.
So ma'am, can you give some examples on uncertainty principle? Because I have heard of like in chemistry, when we draw benzene, so it have a single bond and double bond, but double bonds are moving in that benzene. And we put the circle.
That's what I told you in cell membrane, when the transport of ions takes place for the survival of the cell. This protein, this protein is acting like an active gate for the ion exchange to take place. Okay, it's a part of biochemistry. So that time, though the voltage, there is a, what you can say, impenetrable membrane. But still then this, this is happening. Otherwise, in a very short interval of time, this is happening. See, what happens is a very small change in time interval gives a large change in this variations in energy. So otherwise, this electric field would have forbidden the transport of ions. But you see that the transport of ions takes place. So the transport of ion takes place, it means that definitely the cell is getting survived. Human body is also relying on uncertainty principle, and therefore this happens. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Actually, I had two questions in my mind. My first question is, ma'am, do quantum mechanics also have any limitation, or is it universal? And my second question is, why tunneling occurs? Why quantum tunneling occurs? Thank you.
That's what I told you. First, let me answer your second question first. Quantum, the simple answer to your quantum tunneling is because of the particle is having wave nature. So the wave spreads, the waves, and the probability, right? The probabilistic ideas. That's why I started with a clear-cut difference between the classical ideas and the quantum ideas. Things which were not possible classically are, there is a probability of finding those of, to be possible in the quantum world, okay? So the wave nature, the wave spreads. So there is a probability of finding those particles in the otherwise classically forbidden region. The only answer is the wave particle duality for your second question. The first person is right now, we can't claim that, yes, this is stopped, like. But the thing is, to what extent we can apply, to what limitation? I think in the design of the nanoparticles or nanosynthesis of the this one, that is picking up the atoms by atom and devising it, the fibers of all this one, there is a limit, no? I think 4 nanometers and all, I think, is a limit. Limit is there. The limit is defined by 4 nanometers or something, what I had read. I roughly remember it because I can't recall it right now where I had read it. But the thing is, there is a limit even for the, designing the fibers. The 4 nanometer is the limit, lower limit. So still lower than this, we can't go. And I don't know whether people are thinking about picometers and all, like nowadays, see the previous, so I think 2 decades back, we were thinking about the microscopic, we were in the macro region. Now we are in the nanoscopic world. Who knows in future, we may go still lower, like, because Feynman has already said that there is a lot of space in the, at the bottom where people can experiment and find out new principles or new ideas. So we can't comment right now on this, your first question.
Hi, madam. Great presentation. Thank you for the presentation, madam.
Thank you.
Actually, I didn't have many questions. I just want to comment on this one limitation that you just before said, it's an, in nano, it's 4 nanometers. Mm-hmm. I just want to, I'm from VLSI, actually. And it's my daily job to see that. Yes, I'm from VLSI.
Very large scale integration process, and we are talking about any place.
No, I'm VLSI job.
Yeah, okay, your area topic of specialization is the VLSI. Okay.
So now research are going on, and IBM has recently means I think from last 2 years it has started their research in designing the 3 nanometers. And they succeeded in it by designing
one. This is one, a recent, recent. Okay, thanks for briefing me. I'll even add up to my knowledge that people have crossed the limit and they have reached this 3 nanometer range. Okay, fine. Thank you.
Yeah, they use the technology FinFET. Actually, FinFET is for the 5 nanometers, and they modified their FinFET to some level such that they achieved the 3 nanometer fab chip. Yeah, it can take 1 billion chips on a fingertip.
That's what I told you. The technology is very highly progressing, and people are moving. I don't know. That's what I commented. That is, people may even go to the pico range. Who knows in future, near future. Huh?
Yeah,
because we are comfortable with the nano range. We understood a lot of nano range, but I don't know. People may go still, explore still lower than this, right? They may go to still lower scale, like. Nanotechnology, the nanoscience. I told you, science is a driving force for the technology. Whenever you see the scientific thoughts leads to uses of technology, right? So it is a driving force. Now, why transistors and all were evolved only because of the semiconductor science, right? So nanoscience and nano ideas only will lead to this technology, and therefore these machines will be built up, and definitely that will be useful for the mankind, right? So what else you want me to tell about nano machines and all these machines, like I told you, this electron microscopes and all, these all are atomic level machines which are devised for people to understand or reveal the atomic and subatomic world. That itself is nanotechnology. potent size, you should comment on. The size also is decreasing of the machine size is also decreasing. You see, with the advantage of the technology, how the computer size has reached, right? Now we have come to palm top, right? So this is only because of the nanotechnology, advancement in the nanotechnology. Basically, science leads to technology, and technology is reaching common man's house. Okay, and driving force for science is research. It is refined through research.
Hello, ma'am. It was very good talk. I have one question. Can you comment on how this thermal wavelength, de Broglie thermal wavelength, is related to the interparticle spacing between the atoms to apply the quantum rules? I mean, I read somewhere this is related, but I did not understand how this is really related.
You want to see the spacing between the atoms, okay?
Yeah, that book basically saying that
I understand the physics part of it. See here, if there is a mismatch of wavelength, right, and the size of the obstacle. First of all, to understand this, see why X-rays are used for understanding the crystal structure, because the spacing between the atoms, because you emphasized on the spacing between the atoms, right? So X-rays are used because to obtain the diffraction pattern. Why not visible light? Because the spacing of the between the atoms is also of the order of angstrom unit, and the wavelength of the X-rays is also of the angstrom unit. Okay, so because of this well-defined diffraction pattern you can obtain, and therefore what happens is you can satisfy this Bragg's law and all, and therefore when constructive and destructive interference takes place, and you can reveal the crystal structure, fine. So optical imaging is very much important to understand the atomic sizes and spacing between the atoms and all, or revealing the microscopic structures. Therefore, this optical imaging means what? Again, the optical, the physical principles which are very closely associated with the optical phenomenon are diffraction, interference, right? So then this can happen only when there is some mathematical relation which is governing. So that has to be sizable with the help of the obstacle also. Otherwise, you won't get a pattern. Therefore, for a particular wavelength, the dimensions of the obstacle and the wavelength, they should be very closely related to each other. Otherwise, you can't get the idea about the spacing between the atoms. This is my answer. Now, you ask your question.
I got the answer. Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Okay. Fine.
Yes, ma'am. My question is, which research area are you working on basically now currently?
I'm working in the magnetism area. I'm working on nanoferrites, synthesis of nanoferrites and its characterization and all.
Okay, ma'am. Actually, I am going to start my PhD work on this topic. That's why I searched your Google Scholar page.
Okay, you can request for a paper from my side. I'll definitely share you some papers.
Yeah, you can need some links.
Useful to me. You can get this email address from Yugen Kulkarni. He's my student. Okay, fine.
Okay. So, thank you, madam, for such a wonderful session. And I hope everyone is enjoyed. There was one question. I want to comment on that. It was regarding the uncertainty principle and why the H cross or Planck constant comes there. So, I was doing one... I was attending one lecture by CERN, and the scientists were giving us some tasks. So there was one task that we have given the values, experimental values of delta x, that is the uncertainty in the position, and we have the values, experimental values of uncertainty in the momentum. So we had to plot delta x upon on y-axis we have delta x, and on x-axis we have 1 upon delta p. So if you plot the graph from the experimental data, and if you find the slope of that graph, you will get the slope of around 10 raised to minus 34, which is around the range of Planck's constant. So the experimental facts also satisfying this result. The uncertainty principle tells us the limiting case So experimentally we get more than that. So that might be some relation because of that.
In that relation we write it as greater than or equal to right, h cross. Right. That's right. The lower limit is h cross, not still lower than that. I think right. Even I skipped a slide because I just wanted to show the numerical that delta x the values change in the baseball experiment I had taken. But I just skipped up because I wanted to focus more on the application part and make it more interesting. But even I had that slide of some calculations, numerical calculations, which is justifying for H cross. Okay. Somebody had asked the question also. I could have shared the slide at that time. But I even told you in other way also because it started with H, so it has to end up with H cross only. This is the simple answer I just gave to that guy who had asked me on this one. But we can share that slide where I have personally made some numerical calculations to justify it is H cross, as Eugen rightly said.
So, thank you so much, madam. And thank you, everyone, those who joined and asked questions. So we had a good interaction. I also would like to emphasize that the part of biophysics. So, as madam told, as a physicist, we don't know much about the biology, but still there is some fascinating facts that which we cannot explain without physics. So
that is why I said that those who want to take up research, just connect your research with your life-saving phenomena or life-related phenomena and all. Why don't you go for a interdisciplinary research projects and all? So that you can take your guides as one from physics, one from biology. You can get ideas from the two teachers at a time and try to apply your physical principles to the biological specimens or biological phenomena. So then that research will be recognized. This is the key message you can take from my lecture, that unless and until if you are able to apply your research to some or other areas, then only it will be recognized in near future, right? The thing is, this is the takeaway home message from my today's lecture. You can think about it. So those budding researchers, my appeal to them is just go for interdisciplinary research projects or research areas. Concentrate on that. You will find it more interesting. Your research work only more interesting.
So thank you all. We can end the meeting.